Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service this morning. A very big welcome to all the regular faces, but a very special welcome to our visitors that are here today. We have a saying in the congregation that as soon as you join us for a service, we regard you as being part of the family. So welcome to the family. We hope that you will enjoy the service with us today. Ndia nibulisa, nonke gegama. Lenkosi yetu. Ek groet julle elkeen in die naam van ons Here Jesus Christus. I greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. As we stand, let us sing our first hymn of praise, that hymn being Majesty. Words of Psalm 86 verse 15 comes to call us to worship today. And here we read, O Lord, you are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Today we come together as believers to come and exalt, to come and magnify, to come and worship our Lord. Our Lord who is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Lord who is slow to anger, abounding in love, filled with faithfulness, and the one who showers blessings upon us. So no matter what type of week we've had, God was at our side. No matter what the week ahead of us may be like, God will be at our side. But today, we can come to worship. We can come to sit in the Lord's presence. We can come to glorify our God. And so let's do that by coming into God's holy presence, opening our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our beings, so that God's Spirit can move among us and through us. And we do that in silent and individual prayer. So let us pray. Lord God, we come to you today to worship you, for your greatness knows no bounds. We come to worship you for your faithfulness surrounds us daily. We come to worship you for you are constant and consistent, always there, always close, always holding us in the palm of your mighty hand. Lord, we praise you for what you've done for us in this past week. We praise you for the prayers you've heard and answered. We praise you for those moments of clarity and peace, those moments of care and kindness, those moments of love and compassion you washed over us, so that we may know that you are close and you care. As you were next to us every single moment of this week, Lord, you also know where we got things wrong. Those moments where we sinned against you and our neighbors, in word, in action, in attitude, and in thought. Those moments we just got it wrong. Those moments that we didn't show your love. Those moments where our own way was more important than your way. Lord Jesus, we bring these moments to you now as we come to repent, as we come to confess, as we come to seek your forgiveness in silent and individual prayer. Hear our confessions, Jesus. See our repented hearts. We are sorry, Lord. Pardon us, forgive us, cleanse us, and restore us if our confessions are acceptable in your sight. Let your living waters of grace, mercy, and love flow over us, through us, among us, bringing reconciliation between us and you, but also reconciliation between one another. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your grace and favor, your wisdom and understanding, your compassion and consolation. Lord, as we come to worship you, as we come to hear your word, as we come to be in your presence, Holy Spirit, move among us. Move within us. Move our hearts and our minds to focus upon you. Move our ears to hear you, our eyes to see you, our beings to recognize you, and enfold us, be with us, and connect to us. Thank you, Lord, that we can come and sit in your presence. Thank you for your pardon and mercy. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that we receive from your hand. Amen. We are now going to stand, and we're going to sing the worship song, 10,000 reasons, because there's more than 10,000 reasons we have to worship and be grateful. So let us stand and sing this worship song together.
Bless the Lord. Your holy name. Your
slow to anger. Your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. Tell thousand reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. Time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
Our lectionary reading this morning comes from the Gospel of John, John 9, verse 1 to 47. But because it's such a long reading, we've cut it short to John 9, verse 1 to 12, because it is impossible that Jean must stand here for an hour to read one text to us. So we're reading John 9, verse 1 to 12.
As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work, and while I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with his saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes opened?" they demanded. He replied, "The man they call Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash, so I went and washed, and then I could see." "Where is this man?" they asked him. "I don't know," he said. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jean. Currently, as we know, from all the purple decoration and the fact that it's mentioned every single Sunday, we are in the time of Lent. And as we know, Lent is the time where we become aware of the thorns in our lives. The thorns from the past that keep hurting us, the thorns of the present that cause us harm, the thorns that are self-inflicted because of the choices that we make. And then the thorns that life often throw at us that we just need to handle somehow. Lent is taking all those thorny moments and coming alongside Jesus and allowing him to take those thorns from us and carry it to the cross. Now, as Jesus takes our thorns upon him, we have moments in Lent to reflect. Moments to confess, moments of sadness and suffering, and all those moments we share with Christ. Because if there's anyone that understands suffering, then it is Christ. Now, our lectionary this morning speaks about a certain type of thorn, a thorn that we all battle with, a thorn that we constantly need to examine within ourselves, and a thorn that affects our relationship with God. And that is the thorn of sin. Now, the Gospel of John can be divided into four sections. The prologue, then a section of signs and wonders, a section called the Book of Glory, and then it ends with an epilogue. Now, our reading comes from the section of signs and wonders. And this is a specific section that focuses on Jesus' acts, Jesus' miracles, Jesus' works. And it shows us something about how Jesus viewed sin, how Jesus understood sin, and how Jesus interacted, loved, cared, and healed the sinners. Now, Jesus interacting, loving, showing kindness, and being close to the sinners showed the power of God working through Christ so that people could come to faith. But we also need to remember the main question of the Gospel of John. And the main question that the Gospel of John tries to answer is, who is Jesus? And the answer throughout this whole gospel is that Jesus is the Son of God, the Messiah, the expected one, the Savior. So let's take a closer look at our reading. Jesus and his disciples take a walk around Jerusalem. And then they see a man. But this man was born blind. Now, why is the fact that he was born blind so important? Why do we need to know that? Because as we page through the Old Testament, it is made clear that only God can heal someone born blind. And examples of this is found in Exodus 4 verse 11 and Psalm 146 verse 8. But as we page through the prophet of Isaiah makes it clear that there is one other who can heal something like a disability from birth. And that is the Messiah. And we read that in Isaiah 29, 35, and 42. Now, healers of the day would still be able to help someone who experienced blindness later in life or whose eyes became weak as they grew old. But no one could cure blindness that you were born with. So this immediately sets the scene. It's going to tell us about a healing. But if this man is healed, it tells us more about the one doing the healing than anything else. Because many others have probably tried and failed. So when the disciples see this blind man, they were immediately intrigued with a theological question, a conundrum of sorts. And it's a pesky three-letter word that we all ask. Why? Why was this man born blind? Now we need to bear in mind that the people in the first century had a certain view on illness and disability. In their world, if someone became ill or someone was disabled, it was because God was punishing them. Somewhere they must have done something wrong or horrible, and this is now the penalty that they've got to face. However, when a child, an innocent, a baby, was born ill or disabled, it created a little bit of a problem. Because how can a child or a baby who haven't sinned before be punished? So to bridge this little problem, the Pharisees would quote Exodus 20 verse 5 that says that children can inherit the sins of their parents and grandparents. So this meant that if a child was born with a disability or an illness, then it was the parents' or the grandparents' fault. And God was actually punishing their sins by taking it out on the child. Now, because of this common understanding among the people and even the disciples, when they then see this man who was born blind, they turn to Jesus to find out whether it's true. So they ask Jesus, whose fault is it that this man was born blind? Was it the parents' fault or was it his own fault? And Jesus' answer bowls them over because his answer is simple, neither. It's not the man's fault. It's not the parents' fault. It's no one's fault. And it is also not God punishing anyone. Because honestly, that doesn't make sense. Why would the God of love punish an innocent child who's done nothing wrong because of someone else? That's certainly not how God's love or God's punishment works. However, the issue of fault, the issue of sin, the issue of punishment is still something that we grapple with today. When people are diagnosed with a terminal illness, the question is asked, is God punishing me? Did I do something wrong to deserve this suffering? Why me? When parents are excited because they find out they are pregnant, only to discover later that there's something wrong, the same question is asked. Is God punishing us? Did we do something to deserve this? Why us? When we experience difficult times, trauma, violence, we ask the same question. Is God punishing us? Did we do something wrong? Why us? When a natural disaster such as Cyclone Freddy hits us, as it hit Malawi and Mozambique this past week, we ask the same question. Is God punishing the nation? Did they do something to deserve this natural disaster? Why us? Now, what is Jesus' response to all of this in this reading? Jesus tells his disciples in verse 3, this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. Now, what's that supposed to mean? We need to be very, very careful when we read this verse. With this, Jesus is not saying that the man was born blind so that Jesus could heal him and use him as an example. Jesus isn't giving an excuse here for why this man was born blind. If we turn to the Greek and we read this translation literally, it actually says, in order that God's work might be revealed in this man, it is necessary for us to work the work of the one who sent me. Now, what does that mean? Does that help us at all? What Jesus is really saying here is there is no connection, absolutely no connection, between sin and illness. Rather, Jesus must do the work that God sent him to do on earth. And part of that work is to heal. And seeing that only God and only the Messiah can heal someone born blind, Jesus has to do his Father's will, and he needs to heal the man. The fact that others will see it, that others will come to faith, that others will praise God, that's a bonus. And so Jesus does what God's will is. He bends down, he takes some ground, he spits on it, he places it on the man's eyes. And then he tells him to go and bath in Siloam. Now this bath was just outside the city of Jerusalem, and the water of this bath was specifically used for the temple for purification and cleansing rituals. So Jesus sends the man to be cleansed in the center of the Jewish religious context. Now the man who's blind, who only hears Jesus, goes and he does it. He baths. And in a blink of an eye, he can see. Suddenly, his life changes dramatically. Because someone who was disabled, they were cut off. Because they couldn't contribute to the household by working or bringing in money or fetching water from the well or cleaning, they needed to leave. And on the streets, they then lived off the alms of other people. This also meant that they were viewed as unclean, and therefore they couldn't come to the synagogue, which meant they couldn't connect to God, which meant that when people saw them, they saw the blindness or the disability before they saw anything else. And this is part of the reason that when the man was healed, his neighbors didn't recognize him, because they never really looked at him. They didn't see the man. They saw the illness. They saw the blindness. They saw the sin. However, in the blink of an eye, this man is restored. This man has his sight back. Not back. He has his sight for the first time. But now how others view him totally changes. Because now suddenly they want to interact with him. Suddenly they accept him back into the community. Suddenly he can come back to the synagogue. Suddenly he can connect with God if he wants to. Now what does this reading come to tell us today in the time of Lent? Sin is part of the world. And because sin is part of the world, we are all affected by it. And so bad things happen. Bad things happen, such as disease, such as illness, such as disability, or we should rather use the word differently abled people. Cyclones, droughts, and other natural disasters, they happen. And so when we are diagnosed with a terminal illness or a horrible illness, such as dementia or MS or cancer, or when we are hit by a cyclone or a hurricane, it's not because God is punishing us. It is simply just because life sucks and bad things happen to good and bad people alike. What is horrible, though, is that we all have choices to make. And often people make bad choices, and those bad choices affect us. It's because of someone's choice to murder, someone's choice to rape, someone's choice to be violent, someone's choice to drink and drive, someone's choice to loot, that we all suffer and we experience trauma and we get hurt. But again, this is not God punishing us. And then there are times when we are the ones making the bad choices and choosing the option that's sinful, the option to cause hurt not only to ourselves but to others, the option that causes suffering. And then we need to face the choices of our actions. We have to face the consequences. But what makes God so amazing is that Jesus bends down, he comes to place his hand on our shoulder, and when we go through diseases and illnesses and cyclones and hurricanes and traumas and hurts and suffering, then Christ is right beside us, holding us, being our rock, being our anchor, being the light in the darkness that gives us hope. And those times when our bad choices lead to horrible consequences, then God comes to meet us. And when we repent, he gives us the strength we need to face those consequences of our actions. God never leaves us. God never forsakes us. God never abandons us. God continues to love the sinner and not the sin. God continues to be close to us and will see us through all the thorns of life we face. He will continue to bring us peace and strength, for our God is the God of love, mercy, grace, the God who is slow to anger, the God abounding in faithfulness, as our call to worship states. And so we need to keep our focus upon Christ, upon God, come what may, especially in this week that lies ahead. Many of us may be scared, may be worried, may be wondering what is going to happen tomorrow in our country. But may God protect us all. May God's light shine in the darkness. May God guide us and change the hearts of those who want to destroy, entice violence, and hurt others. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, you know each one of us. You know what we are worried about. You know who we worry about. You know the trauma we face, the problems we have, the challenges that are stacked up against us. You know the anxiety we have, the illnesses we face, the times we are bullied or made fun of, the moments we cry out to you. So Lord, hear our prayers and come and sit with us. Come and console us, come and comfort us, come and heal us, come and be close to us. For we need you every moment of every day. Lord, today we pray for all who are fearful and worried about tomorrow. All those who have been intimidated, all those who are angry, all those who are irritated and frustrated. Lord, please be with our country tomorrow. Protect us, be close to us, look after us, and look out for us. Lord, this morning we pray for all who are fed up with what's going on in our country. Those who've just had enough and want to go to the streets to yell and scream and hope that someone may hear their voice and act. Lord, ease our tempers. Let your peace come down upon us. Let those in power realize what needs to be done and what needs to change to make this country better for all. Lord, we pray for all those who are suffering, all those who are in pain, all those who are asking those why questions at the moment. Bring answers, Lord, to difficult questions. But Lord, also just come and embrace us so that we can feel your closeness and connectedness to us. Be with those who are suffering from PTSD, with those who are hurt due to others' choices, and those who are suffering because of natural disasters. And so we pray, Lord, for the people in Mozambique, Malawi, and Madagascar, and all the other places affected by Cyclone Freddy. Lord, you know how many lives were taken, how many of those are in grief. You know the families who've lost loved ones. You know the families who've lost their homes and their belongings, those who were disconnected from children and parents and who are worried. Lord, have mercy. Come in and embrace all these different families and be with them as they pick up the pieces. Lord, watch over us in this week to come. Connect to us. Be close to us. Come and sit with us in our suffering, in our problems, in our traumas, in our worries. Be with those, Lord, who are going in for operations that are scary. We thank you for your amazing grace, your amazing love, your amazing guidance, your amazing care and kindness. We thank you for the small mercies and great blessings. We praise you, Lord, that you come to free us from sin, that you've come to forgive, and that your grace is amazing and knows no bounds. To you be all the power, all the honor, and all the praise, now and forever. Amen. We are now going to stand, and then we are going to sing the last hymn together, which is Such Love. Then we are going to remain standing for the benediction. Then we are going to remain standing for the exit of the Bible. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing together Such Love. Ubabalo lenkosi yetu uYesu Kristu, uthando lukaThixo, ubudlelwana lomoya uyinkwele, malube nani nonke. En nou mag die genade van God, die liefde van Christus en die gemeenskap van die Heilige Gees, saam met elkeen van julle wees en bly. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and all those whom you love, now and forevermore. Amen.